Like many sports, rugby is best when played on firm, dry ground. Players don't like sliding around in the mud, and waterlogged pitches can ruin a game. It's a subject I know something about, having played the game for 20 years, both in Britain and around the world, 24 times for England and a British Lions tour. Hi, my name's Andy Ripley, and believe it or not, that's me playing on a very wet day. Rugby union is an amateur game, but whether you play amateur or professional sport, you just can't play to a decent standard on bad ground, and this frustrates spectators and players alike. And when games have to be cancelled, the loss of revenue can be enormous, which means that sometimes matches are played in very bad conditions, which can result in damage to a pitch. Perhaps it's just my luck that now I've stopped playing, an answer to the problems of waterlogged pitches has been found, and I don't mean artificial turf. Plastic pitches are unpopular with players, and there's a movement away from them in Britain and in North America. No, the answer I'm talking about, and the subject of this programme, is a completely natural grass surface that has all the characteristics of traditional turf, but with significant improvements. It drains better, it's much more durable, and it assures more frequent use. It's a system that has implications beyond the world of sport, but we'll stay with sport for the moment. It's not only Britain that suffers from the rain. This thunderstorm is happening in Hong Kong, just before a race meeting at the Royal Hong Kong Jockey Club. As you'd expect, the horse's hooves tore up the waterlogged track on the straight. But look what happened when they hit the home bend. There's no divoting, the horses are sure of their footing, and leave hardly a mark on the track. What's the difference between the two stretches of turf? The straight consists of grass growing in soil, but the turf on the bend is growing in sand, and sand drains better than soil. But it's not just sand. It's sand mixed with something rather special and very surprising. This extruded plastic mesh structure lies at the heart of the system I'm talking about. A revolutionary new concept for the stabilization of sand. It looks simple, but in fact it's produced by a very high-tech process that was first developed in Britain over 20 years ago. When small pieces of this mesh are mixed with sand, the particles of sand interlock with the mesh, and the result is a stable and durable matrix which is ideal for growing turf. Turf that can withstand intensive use, even in very wet weather. This new concept, known as the Netlon system, is the result of 5 years' research in the Netlon labs in Blackburn and in British and American universities. These are the pieces of mesh that are mixed with the sand. They are known as the mesh elements, and they are specially designed to give stability and resilience to the sand mesh matrix. Normally, sand or soil will compact under pressure, but the presence of the mesh elements gives the composite an elasticity that allows pressure to be distributed, so minimizing compaction and reducing the possibility of settlement. Since little compaction has occurred, the ground's drainage properties are not affected. When grass grows, the roots intertwine with the mesh elements, interlocking the whole system and thus increasing stability. And what happens when the inevitable thunderstorm occurs? Whereas with conventional soil, water quickly gathers on the surface, the improved drainage ensures that the water passes rapidly through the matrix, leaving the surface firm and playable. So stable is the matrix that very steeply contoured structures can be created, allowing for the construction of almost vertical grass banks that will not erode. As well as the research I mentioned earlier, the Royal Hong Kong Jockey Club conducted extensive practical research into the new system. We saw some of the results of it earlier at the Hong Kong racecourse. The Jockey Club made a short programme, which I'd now like to show you. Horse racing is undoubtedly the most demanding test for the system, and I'll leave you to judge whether or not it passes that test.
In November 1987, the Royal Hong Kong Jockey Club decided to reconstruct its inner city track at Happy Valley using the Netlon system. The decision was made after extensive research and testing at the club's other track at Sha Tin, which had involved relaying the home bend using the new system and testing it over a day's racing. Just before that meeting, the heavens opened. The going on the soil-based sections of the track was described as heavy, but the new home bend remained firm. Race number one, 1,400 meters. As can clearly be seen, the horses caused extensive divoting on the soil track, but this was not the case on the new surface, where they're back up on top of the ground with very little damage to the track. It was this test that convinced the stewards to go ahead with the conversion of the Happy Valley track.
The close season at Happy Valley lasts for 5 months, and the conversion had to be completed in that time if important race days were not to be lost at the start of the new season. It was for this reason that material was prepared off-site well before the last race of the 87 season. The design for the sand mesh track combines ingredients from many parts of the world. Sand required in large quantities to create a deep root zone for the grass is imported from mainland China, coming to Hong Kong by junk and barge after being sieved to achieve the correct grading. Calcine clay, fired to over 1,000 degrees centigrade, comes from the United States and is included to improve moisture behavior without reducing permeability. The unique polypropylene mesh elements come from Blackburn, England, where they're manufactured by Netlon Limited. The last race meeting on the old surface was held at Happy Valley on the 20th of April, 1988, and our contractor moved in with heavy equipment on the following morning. The existing topsoil layer was quickly removed and excavation continued down to the aggregate base, which was topped up with new material and re-leveled when required. The sand mesh composite, together with extra sand needed for the base layer, was then brought to Happy Valley. As is true of many sporting arenas, Happy Valley is surrounded by tall buildings, which cast shadows onto the grass, giving an uneven distribution of sunlight. The new surface must not only accommodate the pounding hooves of the racing horses, but it must also allow grass to grow uniformly throughout, even with the disproportionate degrees of sunlight which will reach the turf. With the sand mesh layer now in place, the surface is leveled and covered with an inexpensive biodegradable cotton cloth, onto which will be placed the stolons which will grow to form the turf. Top dressing is added to encourage fast early growth, as is fertilizer. Another layer of biodegradable cloth then protects the stolons from strong sun and from disturbance by irrigation. Only 1 month after the last meeting, a complete new Netlon track had been laid, with grass planted throughout. August, just 3 months later, and the grass is already well enough established to be cut. Our new track at Happy Valley consists of Tifway Bermuda grass, which requires a 5 month establishment period. But a new washed turf from Australia requires an establishment period of only 1 or 2 months, and this will enable future projects to be completed much more quickly. The first meeting of the new season was to be on the 5th of November, and the new track was in excellent condition, the grass being uniform throughout the whole of the course. The going was good, after a heavy watering of the track in the morning, which would help to give a good, stable footing. Race one. 1,650 meters. A problem on all race courses is the damage caused by the horse's back hooves pushing from a stationary position to give a good fast start to the race. The new surface withstands these forces well. On the short Happy Valley circuit, the horses pass the winning post twice, and as they go around the first bend, we see only puffs of sand with no cutting or divoting. Now, as the jockeys come up to the end of the back straight, they're getting into position for their run to the finish. This starts on the tight home bend, as the finishing straight at Happy Valley is very short. The surface on this 80-meter radius bend, banked at 1 in 15, is subject to shearing forces much greater than normal, as the horses strive to gain position. The new surface withstands these forces well, quite unlike the unconverted sections at Sha Tin, which we saw earlier. The first race was run in almost exactly standard time, indicating good going. 8 races were run that afternoon, giving the new track design its most severe test to date. And at the end of the day, we remain certain that the Netlon sand mesh concept has brought the track of the 21st century to Hong Kong well before the end of the 20th.
After that meeting at Happy Valley, the newspapers were full of praise for the new track, and both jockeys and trainers were enthusiastic. Since then, the Netlon system has been used in the total reconstruction of the Santa Anita track in Los Angeles and in gallops at Newmarket. These players are practicing on grass growing in the sand mesh matrix. The Blackburn Borough Council, looking to the future, decided on the system in 1987 when they constructed this public pitch. Since then, hundreds of games and training sessions have been held here in all kinds of weather. Blackburn Rovers, founder members of the English Football League, practice here regularly under the direction of manager Don Mackay.
The team started training here in October 1987, and regardless of the weather, it would be pouring down rain and we'd be ankle deep in mud down at Ewood Park, and this surface up here would be consistent that we could go on it and train on it. We didn't miss a day's training in the whole of the winter of 1987, which was a very wet winter. In the beginning, the players were a bit apprehensive about the surface because it was a new surface. But once they got used to it and appreciated it, they thoroughly enjoy playing on it because it allows them to demonstrate their skills. But they're a bit concerned with artificial surfaces that you can only wear one pair of boots on it, either rubbers or flats. On this surface, you can actually play with normal studs on it, and it makes it much better that they can train and naturally as playing a game on it. I had a very unfortunate experience of artificial surfaces. I actually played in the Houston Astrodome on AstroTurf, and we played two games there in actual fact, and after both the games, my hips suffered quite dramatically. I had burns on the hips, which I still feel now, which is 26 years since we did that.
We try very hard to keep the ball on the ground and knock it about, therefore the surface must be consistent for us to play on. If we find sometimes when we go away from home, the pitch is very bumpy and bobbly and it doesn't help us playing at all. This surface allows us to play the way we want to play. I can train when I want to train. I can do what I want to do on this surface. The players enjoy training on it. It helps us play. We're running for promotion this season, and I think it's a contributing factor that I can do what I want to do with the players when I want to do it and not have to worry about the elements.
So delighted were the directors of Blackburn Rovers with the new surface, they have since announced that their pitch at Ewood Park will be reconstructed using the new system. We have seen how the system offers a superb natural playing surface that is much more durable and is not affected by wet weather. But as I have said earlier, it has other advantages. For example, it allows for dramatically contoured structures to be created. These are useful in a remarkably wide variety of situations, and one of them is the construction of golf courses. Golf differs from the other sports we've been discussing in that provision must often be made on the playing areas for spectators as well as for players. And of course, there's the additional problem of car parking space, often for thousands of vehicles. Someone who knows a great deal about this is Neil Coles, a professional golfer for 38 years, member of 8 Ryder Cup teams, and winner of more tournaments than even he can remember. In conjunction with Alfred McAlpine Limited, Neil is now heavily involved in the design and construction of new courses. He's talking to David Deese, a director of Alfred McAlpine.
Neil, there's been tremendous changes in golf over the years since you started playing. I mean, the impact of the vast number of spectators that now watch tournament play and the concentration that that makes on our golf course areas. How do you see things have developed in that regard?
The golf courses that were built around the turn of the century were not built to take the traffic that they do these days. And obviously more people want to watch the game. And this has entailed building huge structures to get them above the golf to enable them to watch huge units, unsightly, costly units.
Yes, so of course all of the problems we've been talking about in relation to spectator movement, terracing, substitution of grandstands are things we're building into these new courses that we're doing together. This drawing that we've been looking at really illustrates the problem where you have the natural modern design of the ninth hole and the 18th hole finishing in the same area, the areas will remain green, there will be no sign of wear. We should eliminate some of the muddy problems you get in tournaments today, because the good drainage naturally will be built into the course, and the mesh element system provides that. And some of the features that we're using it for here can of course be added into older golf courses where they have particular problems. I think that the cart track areas, which will undoubtedly be built around these areas, can be made green. And the supplementary use of mesh elements under fairways on the adjoining course for auxiliary car parking. So generally, in terms of the movement of spectators, public areas, tented villages, the applications are quite wide. Well, of course, leaving aside now the spectator areas and the consideration of movement, we should really turn to the more technical aspects of golf itself in relation to tees. And I would think that the work that's been done in research on divot recovery using the mesh element system shows that tees is the first area that will benefit from this.
Absolutely.
I think it's a very exciting future, and the hope that the mesh element system will provide the answers to the problems we've been discussing.
Among the many changes in sport in recent years, not the least is the presence of TV cameras. So visual appeal is now very important. No one likes looking at muddy players and scarred, waterlogged surfaces, and the new system goes a long way towards eliminating these. But it's not only sporting events that suffer. What about other public recreation areas such as parks, campsites, adventure playgrounds and theme parks? All of these are subject to the vagaries of the weather, and they take a great deal of wear from the general public. All could benefit from the new system. These photographs were taken at the Glasgow Garden Festival. The festival architects took advantage of the increased stability offered by the Netlon system when they designed these grass banks and terraces, which added considerably to the visual appeal of the festival. Tens of thousands of people walked over them, and yet they retained their contours throughout the festival with very little damage to the grass. These steep-sided mounds would be impossible to maintain without the new system. Wouldn't spectator terracing of this type be infinitely preferable to the scaffolding structures Neil Coles was discussing? Imagine what capability Brown or Disneyland could have achieved with this system. It's not only aesthetically pleasing, but it's durable. In fact, it's a whole new world of soft architecture which will revolutionize the landscaping of our natural environment. I find the Netlon system very exciting, and so do sports administrators on four continents, which is not surprising when you consider the loss of revenue from cancelled fixtures that will be saved when all outdoor sports are played on this new surface. We've always been told not to build our houses on sand, but just look at this demonstration of the stability of this system and draw your own conclusions. Two piles of sand. Not surprisingly, the one on the left collapses when Colin Hendry of Blackburn Rovers stands on it, but the pile on the right is mixed with the mesh elements. Just watch this. Safe as houses, as they say. Thanks, guys. Finally, we just couldn't resist showing you this photograph of a try being scored in New Zealand. You could almost mistake it for a water polo match. There is still a long way to go before sports players are completely free from this type of thing, but at least, as we've seen, there is relief coming. A completely natural playing surface that will resist the damage done by that all too common enemy of players and spectators alike, the rain.
The sun is out, the sky is blue, there's not a cloud to spoil the view, but it's raining. Raining in my heart. The weatherman says clear today. He doesn't know you've gone away, and it's raining. Raining in my heart. Oh, misery. Of me, I tell my blues they mustn't show, but soon these tears winds are bound to blow, 'cause it's raining, raining in my heart. But it's raining, raining in my heart. And it's raining, raining in my heart. Oh, of me. I tell my blues they mustn't show, but soon these tears are bound to flow, 'cause it's raining, raining in my heart.